Penguin Random House Audio presents Strange Harvests, The Hidden Histories of Seven Natural Objects by Edward Posnett. Read for you by Roy McMillan. Introduction. A few years before writing these words, I was working in Canary Wharf in a glass building filled with experts on numbers and systems. As part of my job, I wrote reports on companies, markets, and political conditions in distant countries. The subjects of my research were serious: million-dollar oil deals in Africa, rogue trading scandals, bribery allegations in the North American construction sector. But looking out the office windows, or walls, toward North London, I felt none of that gravity, only a dulling sense of the distance between the words I wrote and their meaning. One of London's two financial centres, Canary Wharf sits on the site of the old West India Docklands in a loop of the River Thames. Ships once crammed into its docks to offload rum, sugar and coffee from the West Indies into brick warehouses, now restaurants and apartments. The docks thrived for almost 200 years until the late 1960s, when the arrival of the container prompted the shipping industry to move farther east. In 1983, most of the land was sold to a developer. Within a few years, the dock's history was buried under layers of glass and steel, the architecture of a much more liquid capital. Anyone who has visited the Canary Wharf area in East London will know how easy it is to get lost there. To the untrained eye, the district fades into itself. The glass buildings on any two streets seem the same, but arranged in a different order. In the Library of Babel, Jorge Luis Borges imagines a vast library containing all the possible 410-page books made of 25 characters. In countless hexagonal rooms, four walls of bookshelves hold Borges's imaginary books, made up of different permutations of the same letters. Something about my routine in Canary Wharf reminded me of this short story. Each report that I wrote merged with its predecessors. The words, after all, were the same: shareholder, oil block, concession, acquisition, investigation. Only their order, their syntax, was different. During my lunch breaks, I would go running in the Isle of Dogs, thinking of the ships that once came here and the materials they brought from distant parts of the world: ivory, molasses, wool, and hides. The Docklands would have smelled different, the odour of these commodities blown by the wind from the Thames. Breathing the air, one might have gotten a sense of the world growing smaller, each object testimony to new trade links, the speed and reach of the ships of the East India Company. It must have been intoxicating to witness this influx of the exotic, but also disconcerting, as the safe, known world mingled with the unfamiliar and strange. In London, Antwerp, Venice, and other centres of international trade, thinkers tried to make sense of this new world, these smells, sights, and textures. Some wrote about these new connections, travelling to distant lands, but others found ways to represent them through objects. Collectors like Hans Sloane, John Tredescant, and Ole Wurm gathered objects from around the world and placed them in single rooms or wunderkammers, creating a world of wonders in one closet shut. More than eccentric collections, these rooms sought to represent the expanding limits of knowledge, to visualize the connections between things and understand networks of relationships. As historian Mark Meadow writes, "In the world of the curiosity cabinet, as in any other place or period, the strands of blood, trade, authority, and agency were all present and were all interdependent. To touch any of the strands is to set all the others in sympathetic vibration." My favourite Wunderkammer belonged to the Danish physician and classics professor Ole Wurm. In 1605, Wurm set off on a grand tour that would last 8 years, travelling to Germany, Italy, France, England, and the Low Countries. As he went, he gathered objects and met with men of learning, such as the famous collector Ferrante Imperato in Naples. These items ranged from seeds, shells, and horn to mirabilia, or marvels, including a magic egg said to have been laid by a woman in Norway. Wurm conserved these things, he wrote, "with the goal of, along with a short presentation of various things' history, also being able to present my audience with the things themselves to touch with their own hands and to see with their own eyes, so that they may themselves judge how that which is said fits with the things, and can acquire a more intimate knowledge of them all. During the 16th and 17th centuries, many individuals were collecting objects from the natural world, Athanasius Kircher and Ulisse Aldrovandi, as well as Imparato. Children of the Renaissance, they looked largely to classical texts to explain the objects in their collections, tracing their appearance in works such as Pliny's Natural History or Aristotle's History of Animals. Verne was influenced by these collectors, but he was fascinated by touch, the sensual experience of interacting with objects. In his preface to the catalogue of his collection, the Musei Vermiani Historia, he wrote of the clear intention to lead toward knowledge by direct observation and away from hollow verbiage. Holding an object, passing one's finger over it, smelling it, one could perceive truth and debunk myths. I didn't know about the Museum Vermianum while I worked in Canary Wharf, but had I known, I might have spent hours poring over the catalogue during breaks. Writing in the 17th century, Verne found himself at the beginning of a process, the commodification of the natural world, that has reached its apex in our own age. As he wrote, collected, travelled and touched, ships owned by private enterprises such as the Virginia Company voyaged to the Indian subcontinent or the New World, trading spices, seeds, tobacco and fibre. Many of the objects in his museum possessed a narrative simplicity, casting a straight line from the natural world to the room of his museum. But others spoke of these complex new trade routes, weaving patterns, contacts and relationships, sprouting branches in their passage from the wild to his own hands. It intrigued me to think of what Verne would make of our era, a time when almost everything has become a commodity, a tradable object, a time when the exotic is now the domestic, arriving in shops and warehouses as if spontaneously generated. My own work in my Canary Wharf office traced objects' movements, detailing the exchange of materials and things across borders, from the spare parts of aircraft to underwear to oil derivatives. When Verne perceived his new objects, he experienced a sense of rupture with the old ways of seeing, a radical break prompted by encounters with texture. And yet I didn't sense any rupture in my daily routine, only a continual procession of goods, one measured by abstract figures. It's difficult to measure time when you work in Canary Wharf. The market lives eternally in the present. Each unprecedented, unforgettable event swallows the last before it too is swallowed and replaced. Then there's the lack of natural light in Canary Wharf. You can remain underground or inside from the moment your train or tube arrives in the station until you finish your workday. I started measuring the passage of time by peering down at the Crossrail station development on the North Dock, some 50 metres below my desk, a stretch of water that once held up to 200 ships from the West Indies. The development began as an enormous cube of empty space below the water level, propped open by thick metal tubes. Gradually, the gap filled with cranes, men, blocks of concrete and girders. By the time the cranes reached my line of sight, I decided that it was time to move on. After I left finance, I tried everything and nothing. Teaching, archival research, advocacy for a charity, running activities in a homeless shelter. Depending on the day, I felt either a deep sense of relief or a crippling sense of failure. I began reading histories and articles about commodities and extraction, delving deeper into the stories I had skimmed in Canary Wharf. Instead of finding closure, I was left with a vague sensation that by simply existing, eating food, breathing and excreting, I was caught up in stories I did not understand. In his book Invisible Cities, Italo Calvino imagines a place called Ercilia, where, to establish the relationships that sustain the city's life, the inhabitants stretch strings from the corners of the houses, white or black or grey or black and white, according to whether they mark a relationship of blood, of trade, authority, agency. So abundant did these threads seem in my own life that they merged to form a single dark fabric, where everything was at once connected and separate. One weekend, I visited the London Wetland Centre in Barnes, an artificial wetland hidden within another loop of the Thames on the site of four disused Victorian reservoirs. I found it invigorating to wander along the wetland's paths, stopping to view its lagoons and islets. I saw Canada geese, plovers, mallards and eiders, wildlife from several continents, all within 105 acres. I stopped in front of the eiders. Large sea.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.